Yeah, thanks. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to give a talk. I'm Yvette, I'm a PhD student in the Netherlands, working at Leiden University. And yeah, I'm happy to present you our current project, namely incorporating primordial non-Gaussianities in the framework of effective theory of large-scale structure. This project is done in collaboration with Valentin Assassi, Daniel Bauman, Enrico Paier, and Drian van der Woude, who's sitting over there. They have been working actually quite hard to get the paper published this week, and tomorrow it will appear on archive, so stay tuned. The bottom line of the project is that we develop a consistent perturbation theory for dark matter with non-Gaussian initial conditions. That's better. The motivation is that we would like to improve the sensitivity on measuring primordial non-Gaussianities. Suppose we were able to detect primordial non-Gaussianities, then we directly probe into the early universe, and we will find a wealth of information. Turns out that most extended models of inflation, predict a certain amplitude of above a certain threshold of non-Gaussianity given by FNL of order 1. So if we would be able to reach the sensitivity of FNL equal to 1, then even in absence of a detection, we would learn quite a lot. So are we going to look at large-scale structures or the CMB? The CMB, of course, is very nice because you can describe it by linear physics. However, the amount of information you can get from there is quite limited because it's only a two-dimensional survey, so the information scales with area. And moreover, we only have access to a limited range of scales because on large scales it's limited by cosmic variance, whereas on the small scales we have silk damping. So we should probably turn our attention to large-scale structures, which is a three-dimensional survey, so the information scales with volume. However, there's many sources of late-time nonlinearities, which makes this problem very complicated. And the range of scales we can describe is actually a question mark. So the effective theory of large-scale structure is an approach to go into the mildly nonlinear regime. To give you an idea of what all the challenges are, if we want to start with primordial non-Gaussianities, we first of all have to understand the non-linearities induced by gravitational interactions. And then secondly, we don't measure actually the dark matter distribution, but we measure galaxies or halos, and we have to understand the bias between them. Then also the galaxies, they have peculiar velocities, so there are redshift space distortions. And there are many other effects we have to understand, so it's very challenging. In this project, we only focus on the description of the dark matter perturbations. And we focus on the bias spectrum as an observable. So dark matter bias spectrum, So how are we going to extract this primordial non-Gaussian signal? The first thing you have to do is fully understand the background. So we fully have to understand the non-linearities induced by gravity. And this has been done in this paper, for example, and also a paper by Leonardo Senatore, by the way. And the second thing is that we have to understand how gravitational nonlinearities affect the signal we want to measure, namely primordial non-Gaussianity. And from there, we can, if we understand this, then we can try to answer the question how distinct primordial non-Gaussianity is from the background, and how well we can distinguish between different types of primordial non-Gaussianity. So let me illustrate this last point by this picture. So here is plotted the relative ratio of the contribution to the bias spectrum coming from non-Gaussian primordial initial conditions as function of scale, and such that you can see for three types of primordial non-Gaussianity what the relative scaling is. And you can see on large scales they scale quite differently, but on the due to the corrections due to gravitational non-linearities on the smaller scales, you can see they start scaling in the same way. So actually, that this is a bad thing. Okay, let me just go back to the problem. So how are we going to solve the fluid equations for dark matter? So dark matter is a collisionless particle, so it's described by the Vlasov equation. Taking the first two moments, you will end up with the fluid equations, which you already have seen before, which looks schematically like this. So there's a linear time evolution operator, and on the right-hand side you can, for the density contrast of dark matter, and on the right-hand side there's the nonlinear corrections, and actually there's also some velocity dispersion term for the short scales. And the old way, let's say, to solve it was just by neglecting this velocity dispersion and then solve perturbatively for the density contrast. So first solve the linear equation, then use the Green's function to solve order by order. However, as Matthias Salariaka already pointed out, there are some problems with this approach. Namely, the small scales are don't have a small density contrast. So actually, there's no well-defined perturbation parameter. And since we don't solve the short-scale physics by this approach, we don't know what they are. And we also don't know how they back-react on the long scales. And moreover, the loops in this approach, which couple the long scales to the short scales, they give the wrong result because we don't solve in the right way for the short scale perturbations. All right, so I put all those problems in the left hand side of this table. So the effective theory of Lasker structure is a way to solve all these problems. And the idea is that you're going to smooth over the short scales, so integrating out the short scales. This means that you end up with a set of equations which only describe long wavelength perturbations. So it means that then you will have a well-defined perturbation parameter. So that already solves the first problem. Also, because we integrate out the short scales, this should give rise to corrections to the equation of motion, because parameterize the back reaction of the short scales on the long scales. So this will give rise to an effective stress tensor. But that doesn't mean that we know the physics of the short scales. So the only thing we can do is parameterize our ignorance. So we assume that the short scales depend locally on the long wavelength perturbations. And then we expand also consistent with the symmetries of the problem. And then we expand the stress tensor in the long wavelength fluctuations. And this will describe the back reaction of the short scales. Then it turns out that these new terms in the equation of motion will exactly provide the right counter terms to renormalize the loops. And then we end up with the right result. So the effective theory of Lasker structure solves all the problems at the same time. Now, in this paper, we want to include primordial non-Gaussianities. So in this framework, so we smooth over the short scales and expand the stress tensor. This was done in these papers before, and especially this one for the bispectrum. And because we start with non-Gaussian initial conditions, the long and short scales are initially correlated. So this will give rise to new terms in the effective stress tensor proportional to the primordial potential. So this is a very sketchy way to show it, but in the paper we define large classes of non-Gaussianity by their scaling and angular dependence, and we classify all the contributions to the stress tensor in a systematic way. Anyway, so this will give us a consistent perturbation theory, and we solve the perturbation theory to first order in non-Gaussianity and loops. And we check explicitly that all the counterterms provide the right counterterms to renormalize the loops. Then in the second part of the paper, we do a numerical evaluation of all the non-Gaussian contributions to the bispectrum. So we compute the linear contributions, the loop contribution, the counterterms. And a question you can ask is how well can we distinguish primordial non-Gaussianity from the gravitational non-linearities, for example? And this the answer will depend on, for example, the amplitude of the signal, the scale dependence, relative scale dependence, and the range of scales we can reliably describe. We didn't do a full analysis, but I will just show you a couple of plots to give you an idea. So this is an example where we started with local primordial non-Gaussianity with FNL equal to 10. And here I plotted all the contributions to the bispectrum in the equilateral configuration, again as function of scale. So here the blue lines, that's really the part which comes from gravitational non-linearity. So this is the background. The red part is also the background, but it's just an estimate of the background. So actually the red line will denote how bad we actually know our background. And then the black lines denote the non-Gaussian signal. So here you can see in the equilateral configuration, we don't really trust a large range of scales, because here the higher order corrections to the background seem to become important. So 10, yeah. So here we can only describe the non-Gaussianity up to this scale. And but if we go to the squeeze configuration, the situation looks much better. And we see that the estimate of the higher order contributions are lower than all the non-Gaussian contributions to the bispectrum. So this gives us hope that we might be able to detect non-Gaussianity in the primordial non-Gaussianity in the bispectrum. And moreover, also the counterterms. We plotted actually the counterterms with a coefficient, but actually we don't know the coefficient, so it could be also a little bit lower or higher. But they seem to be important, and we have to include them in the analysis. For the full analysis, we would like to do a Fisher analysis, so that's what we are working on right now, to make more precise how well we can constrain primordial non-Gaussianity from the bispectrum. Then another thing which would be nice to do is fitting to N-body simulations to fix the parameters in the effective stress tensor, such that if you in the end want to compare to observations, then you only need to measure FNL. But before you can actually compare to observations, you first have to understand the halo bias or galaxy bias and redshift space distortions. So including primordial non-Gaussianities also has to be extended to these things. The summary of the project is that we have extended the effective theory of large scale structure with non-Gaussian initial conditions. We found new terms in effective stress tensor, which provide exactly the right counterterms to renormalize all the loops. And we did a numerical evaluation of the contributions to the bispectrum. And tomorrow you should check the archive. I would be very happy if you want to have more details to discuss it maybe later on. Or you can, of course, ask me any question right now.